Has class started yet? Wait a minute, is this the right place? Oh no, I've made a terrible mistake.
Oh, hi. I'm Mark. I used to be a senior artist at Blizzard Entertainment, and now I teach art for a living. In this new magical episode of my weekly series that I've been calling YouTube Art School, I'm going to teach you what you need to focus on to become an environment artist. We'll look at what you need to know and practice and in what order to become a pro, or at least to get good. Uh-oh. Quickly, let's get this class started. This week, it's all about environment art. I actually started my career as an environment artist before transitioning to character art, so it's a topic that I know quite well. Environment art is so fun. You get to create a world out of nothing, like a god. In this week's class, we'll be going over the different skills that you should invest in to get good fast. Just like an RPG game where you can spec as a mage or a thief or a warrior, whatever. As an artist, you also have a few different specializations to choose from. I already did the Character Artist Starter Pack a few weeks ago, so have a look at that if you're more into characters. I'll put the link down in the description. But things are quite different for environment artists, so let's see what exactly is in the Environment Artist Starter Pack. Time to level up. And class is in session, so pay attention. Also, before we get going, pay the class fee of either one like or one sub, or else... The first skill that you should heavily grind XP for if you're going to be an environment artist is obviously perspective. I say first because we'll be looking at six fundamental skills today, all marked in the video timeline for convenience. Perspective comes first, and by the way, this list of skills is in the order that you should study for them. There's going to be a natural progression here, and it won't work nearly as well if you mess up the order. Kind of like exploring a zone that you're not ready for just yet in a game where the NPCs or the monsters are just way too strong for your current level. You're gonna have a harder time. Same here. You gotta take it one step at a time. You don't have to be so strict about it, but try to follow the order as much as possible. It's obviously super simplified for this video, but it's the exact same approach that I take in my art program because it works best. And by the way, check out the description of the video for a big discount on the art school program, extended until the end of the month only. Oh snap! Perspective then. We start with this particular fundamental because it's at the root of nearly everything when it comes to environment art. It's kind of like anatomy for character art. You just can't skip the skill. I know it might seem daunting and complicated if you're not super familiar with it, but it's a lot easier than it seems. Way easier than learning anatomy. You can start super simple, just drawing shapes and giving them thickness. But sooner than later, you'll want to understand the basics. The horizon, vanishing lines, one-point perspective, two-point perspective, 3 points and more. And how to draw basic yet accurate volumes like cylinders and boxes in space. You can take it one step further by placing those volumes in a room, which is basically just a big box, and then drawing a few more to create more complex structures. Even though complex here might be an overstatement. All these simple exercises I quickly showed are great to practice. So have a go at them if you're just starting. This is the foundation, and it will get pretty easy with just a little bit of practice. The second skill that you'll then want to focus on as an artist focusing on environment art will be the construction skill. The fundamental of construction, or how to draw the building blocks that make up everything that we draw or paint. Just like I was drawing simple volumes when discussing perspective, construction is similar, but it takes things a bit further. Instead of simple volumes, here we'll be focusing on structures, a group of volumes. Imagine you take some simple boxes, triangular prisms, cylinders, and arrange them in such a way that now we're left with a structure that reminds us of a simple house. That's construction. You lay down the basic perspective first and set the rules. Then, during the construction phase, using simple geometric volumes, we focus on laying down as much of the scene as possible. No details yet! By the way, this is mostly relevant if you draw man-made structures, not as much when drawing nature only. Unless you have some large structures like big rock formations or cliffs. The next skill that we'll want to be collecting XP points for is composition, how we arrange the various elements within our canvas. Unlike a character that can be on its own against a white background, where the composition won't be as relevant, environments are usually not like that. We limit what we show to the viewer with our canvas choice, whether we use a portrait or a landscape ratio. When there are more than one element on the canvas, like I have here, it's important to help guide the eye of the viewer like an author does by having clear chapters, paragraphs, and all kinds of text formatting. Composition in art is just like text formatting for writers. There are many types of composition ratios to help us place the elements in our drawing or painting within the canvas in a nice way. Ratios that old masters came up with that just work so well that we still use them today. I'm sure you've heard of like the golden ratio, for example, or the rule of thirds. The most important thing to focus on at first will be your focal point, the one area of your artwork that should stand out the most. These ratios can help figure out where that should be, among other things. The rule of thirds, for example, well, just place your focal point on either of these intersections. And your focal point can really be anything, but it's typically a point of interest, like the house here in my case. Another thing to keep in mind regarding composition will be the amount of detail that you use. Always use more in the foreground, a little less in the middle ground, and much less in the background to give your artworks a sense of depth. You can also think of it as having more details around your focal point and gradually less as you move away from it. Doing the opposite will flatten your image. Careful! The fourth skill is design. So far, it's been pretty technical, but it's at this point that you'll let the creative side take over. Obviously, I don't want my little house to look like a toy, void of details. That's not good. At this stage, I'll normally want to go search the interwebs for cool design ideas. When drawing vegetation, look up different types of plants and trees and try selecting a few that you'll be reusing for your own art. Same with buildings. You can't draw a cool building or a house in this case if you don't know what that might look like. Find references like different types of windows or doors, roof types, and what kind of materials that you can use for those. Collecting references to help your designs is just like collecting ingredients for a recipe or for crafting in a game. The real skill here is really in how you arrange those ingredients. On another note, you'll also want to make sure that you have good shape language, aka don't use too many ingredients. A simple way to go about it, if it's not something that you're super familiar with, could be to focus on similar shapes. If you find a roof reference that you really like, for example, but it's all pointy, like a witch's hut, you'll want to use other pointy elements for the rest of the design too. Maybe pass on the round windows and go for something maybe more triangular? I have a popular class on drawing simple environments using very few ingredients, nature only. So check it out if you want something simple that you'll be able to try right away. I think it's one of my best classes. Anyways, link in the top right corner of the screen and down in the description. The fifth skill, and we're almost done, maybe more of a two-in-one, is going to be color and light theory. When it comes to environments, this is by far my favorite step. It's where everything comes to life. I have it towards the end of the environment starter pack because it implies that you have something to color. The light part is also more technically difficult because it means that you'll be drawing or painting shadows, understanding how cast shadows work and how and when to use ambient occlusion and how to properly use atmospheric perspective. Why not toss that in there too? Now, when it comes to colors, just like with character art, it's all about balance. A balance between saturated and desaturated colors. Balance of cool and warm colors. A balance in the levels of contrast throughout the piece. More contrast in the foreground, less contrast in the background. I recently posted a class on color theory, so I'd definitely recommend that you check that one out for a lot more information about colors. Link in the top right corner once again and down below. When focusing on the lighting of the piece, to a good extent, you really don't have to be any good at shading to get good results. What I'm doing here is just a more detailed version of this right here. Select a direction for the light, let's say it's coming from above, then select all the faces that are pointing up, or kind of pointing up, then paint in the lights. Wow, it's so easy, a baby could do it. It's a lot simpler, obviously, when the surfaces are flat, so if you're not super experienced but still want cool-looking lighting for your environments, keep the structure simple, blocky. Finally, the last skill of the starter pack. Not a fundamental this one, but a very important skill nonetheless. Brushcraft. What the heck? Brushcraft as in how well you know and use your brushes. When painting complex environments with lots of details like trees, foliage, Rocks, dirt, grass, water, you name it. Custom brushes will be your friends. There is not a single professional environment artist who doesn't use custom brushes to speed up their work. The more you know your tools, in this case your brushes, the better an environment artist you'll be. You should also learn how to create custom brushes. That's pretty important. A good brush set shouldn't be too large, maybe a few dozen brushes at most. But you should know them all so well that you can actually find more than one use for each, essentially making you feel like you have more than you do. Good brushcraft is also in the way that you use detail. I talked about it a little bit when discussing composition, but it's always best to have more details around your focal point and less as you move away from it. Using bigger brushes that are not too noisy for the background elements and smaller brushes with maybe more texture for the elements that are closer in the scene. If you look at the ground next to you right now, I'm sure you can see a bunch of small details, right? Like the details in your carpet, maybe some lint, crumbs of Doritos, etc. If you just look a few meters away though, those details start to be a lot harder to see. And if you look far enough, they just disappear. You can't see them anymore. Use the same logic when painting. Close up, more details. Far away, no details. Easy. And this brings me to my set of free brushes that, oh my god, you can actually download right here in the top right corner of the screen and down in the description. Even better, I made a class on how to use them properly. Check it out, link in the top right corner once again. And that's it for today's class. I hope the path of an environment artist is a little clearer now. Focus on grinding XP for all those skills that we saw today, and you'll be creating awesome environments in no time. Well, maybe a little time, but way faster than your foolish friends who didn't watch this class. Now, be sure to enable notifications if you still haven't to be on time for next week's class. By popular demand, we'll finally be covering the topic of oh no, I've made a terrible mistake.